Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers. NYSUT's 600,000 members are building a brighter future in New York State classrooms, universities, and healthcare facilities. NYSUT, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Ed Hathaway. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Now, here's how the show works. There's teachers in I have a teacher standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
Easy for you to say. If you'd like help with your homework, please call Dial Teacher Free at 888-986-2345.
Now, you can also send us your comments on our new website, thehomeworkhotline.org, and just click on that Yak Back button and send in your comments.
All right. Now, we'll get to our first question in a minute, but it's Thursday, and that means Mr. Z has a science challenge for us.
I do.
What's up?
Before I start the science challenge, though, I got to give a shout out to Miss Parchment's grade class at number 17 school. We said hello to them today, and they watched the show.
Oh,
so,
how
cool.
Fun.
So,
hi, guys. Thanks for watching.
Now, science challenge. Last week, Craig did something with Newton's law. We're going to use one of Newton's law. So let me show you what we have here first, Ed. I've got this board, and you can see there's some cork here and some rubber here, a piece of sandpaper, and like a piece of cardboard. So there's four different surfaces here.
Gotcha.
All right. And what we have here is just a weight, a mass, on a little wooden block with a hook on it.
So you tape it to that, yeah.
Yep. All right. And then we have a scale here that's going to measure our force here in newtons.
Okay.
Now, when we talk about a force, the force is a push or a pull. In this case, we're going to use a pull because we're using this.
And it can be measured.
And it can be measured. All right. So I'm going to start out with our little weight, our little mass here on this surface, and I want you to notice that once I start pulling, I see if this will show up. Yep. Notice once I start pulling that is a pretty even measurement.
That is nice and smooth.
Yeah. Okay. And that was a measurement of just about a newton. All right. This spot here would be one newton, so it's just about a newton of force we got there.
Gotcha.
All right. Let me do it here on this surface. All right.
If I can get that shot they got there. If you can hook it up.
Yeah, if I can hook it up. All right.
There we go.
We'll try again. And notice now that I'm pulling, the force is almost 3 newtons.
Really went up. That is so interesting.
About 2.9.
Okay.
All right. And we do a different surface here, and we can see that it's, this is about 2.2.
Okay.
So, this was the same mass each time. But it required a different amount of force to move it.
Depending on, right?
And so Newton said for every reaction, there's an equal and opposite reaction. But our question's going to be, what was this force that I actually was measuring with this balance when I was pulling it across these different surfaces? Okay. And then in our discussion, we'll talk about that a little bit more.
Okay, so the question is, what is the force? It's not the surfaces that you're using.
No.
I thought that's where you were going to.
No.
All right. Now, if you think you could solve the science challenge, please give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904, or you can just answer at our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
But every correct response will be added to our Hotline Hall of Fame, and earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
Well, that is interesting. But so, I think we're going to go to a math question here.
Okay. Hello.
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 Hi. Is this Rachel?
Yeah.
Hi, Rachel.
Hi, Rachel.
How are you?
Good.
All right. I'm going to take this one, Mr. Z.
Okay.
Hey.
Rachel, I'm ready. What's your math question?
A school banana has 8 equal parts.
Okay.
One half of the petals are green.
Okay.
And one fourth of the petals are blue.
Okay. So it's a school banner. This isn't going to be really even. Okay, so I'm going to back us up a little bit, Rachel, okay? Thank you for reading that question. So we got a school banner here. It's kind of like a flag, isn't it? Banners are kind of like a flag that they put up on the wall. Okay, the first part, you said one half of them were green?
Yeah.
Okay, so one half of them are green. If you have eight pieces, what is one half of eight? Do you know, Rachel?
Four.
Very good. So I'm going to get our green color going. Now put a G in here for green, and I'll mark four of the panels as green. Okay, what did it say about blue, Rachel? What did it say about blue?
1/4 of the panels are blue.
Okay, so if you have the number 8 and you divide it by 4, do you know what 8 divided by 4 is equal to?
2.
2, it is 2. All right, very good, Rachel. So for the blue, I'll mark 2 of them blue. Okay, what does the rest of the question say again, Rachel?
The rest of the panels is yellow. How many panels are yellow?
Okay, I don't have a yellow marker up here, but I'll go back to that color. I'll go back to our dark color. All right, so there's only 2 left, isn't there, Rachel?
Right.
So that would be our
2.
Yellow. So, very good. So 2 of the 8 panels are left, so they must be marked in yellow, right?
Right.
That was a great question. You're learning fractions, you're learning to divide, and you're doing some real logic here. That was a great question. Tell your teacher I said thank you.
Okay.
Thanks, Rachel. Bye-bye.
I said, hey, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Okay, we've got another caller on the line.
Right.
Hello, Denasia, are you there?
Yes.
Okay, now what grade are you in?
I'm in 7th.
All right, I'm going to go to the board. I understand
yes.
You have a math question too, right?
I'm in 7th.
In 7th, okay. Denasia, turn your TV down. Just listen to me on the phone. There's a bit of a delay, and I think we're confusing you there, okay? Okay, are you there?
Yes.
Okay, what's the question you have?
20 over T.
Okay.
Oh, the question, use cross product.
Okay.
To solve each proportion.
Okay, so then we have 20 over T is equal to something, right?
It equals to 2.5.
Okay.
Yes, 2.5.
Over six. Okay, let's talk about this. They told us they were going to use cross products, right?
Yes.
Okay, and this is a proportion. Why do we say this is a proportion?
Yes.
Why would we say this is a proportion? What does it mean if things are proportional?
We say it again.
What does it mean that it says this is a proportion? What does it mean if these two things are proportional to each other?
To cross multiply.
Well, we are going to cross multiply to get it, but these are proportional. Notice we have an equal sign in here in the middle of this, right?
Yes.
Yep. When we're all done, whatever the value of this one is going to be the same as the value of that one. Okay, and so to go from one to the other, we could multiply them both by some number, whatever we multiply the numerator by the denominator, and it would be equal to this one over here. But the easiest way to solve this one was, like you said, we cross multiply or the cross products, because product is the answer when we multiply, right?
Yes.
Okay, so tell me what we want to do. Which two are we going to do first? When we say that, we're going to multiply these two by each other, right? And we're also going to multiply these two by each other, right?
20 and 6.
All right, so one side is going to be 20 times 6, okay? And the other side would be?
2.5 times T.
Okay. Now, 20 times 6, could you do that in your head? Let's do it this way. What's 2 times 6?
2 times 6 is 12.
And then the 0 on the end because we're multiplying by 10, right? And
yes.
We'll bring down our 2.5 times T. And what do we want to do? What do we need to do in our next step?
We need it to divide.
We do. We want to get that T by itself, right? And right now it's being multiplied by 2.5, so we're going to do what? We're going to divide by what?
6.
Well, not by 6. Okay, let's go back to this. Notice that we hit
2.5.
Right, the 2.5. We want to get that t all by itself, and right now, since it's being multiplied by 2.5, we need to do whatever we do to one side to the other, right? Now, 2.5 divided by 2.5 is going to give us 1, and 1 times t would be t, right?
Yes.
Okay, so to get this side, we have to divide 120 by 2.5. Should we do it over here on the side?
Yes.
Okay. So 2.5 into 120. What do we have to do first if we have a decimal here?
We need to move it over.
We do. We move it over, and so what do we got to do here? We need to add a zero, right?
Yes.
Yes, because we moved that over. All right, now put our decimal point up top. So first, now we don't have 2.5, we have 25. 25 is not going to go to 1. It's not going to go to 12, but it will go into 120, won't it?
Yes.
How many times?
Four.
Very good. So 4 times 25 is going to give us
100.
Next step would be to subtract and get our 20, right? And now what should we do?
We need to see how many times 25 goes into 100.
Well, we not into 100, but we have, now we did 4 times 25. We got our 100. We subtracted, right?
We need to subtract.
Yep, and we have 20 left, right?
Yes, and we need to bring down the zero to give us 200.
You got it. Now, if 25 went into 100 4 times, how many times is it going to go into 200?
8.
You got it. Nice job. All right, and 8 times 25 is going to be 200. We'll have no remainder, right? And so our answer is T is equal to?
48.
All right. Nice job. Okay? Very good.
Yes.
So you got the idea of the cross products down. You did a great job on your proportion.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks for calling.
I said, hey, hey.
King Philip came over for great spaghetti. It's a silly way to remember the classification of animals and plants in science. The classification order is kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species.
And we'll get back to the questions in just a moment, but first, let's take a look at this week's Hotline Book Reviews. Check them out.
The story I read was Rachel Crow from the Heart, written by Riley Brooks. This story is about Rachel Crow. She was on the X Factor. She is a solo singer and went to the finals. Rachel Crow was born on January 23rd, 1998. She loves to watch the movie Titanic. Her parents said that she was born to sing. They were so determined for her to become a singer that they moved all the way to LA so that Rachel could audition for the X Factor. She auditioned and went to the finals. She was eliminated the 10th week of the finals. She was devastated, but eventually she got a record deal with Columbia Records. She had her first song called Mean Girls, and she co-wrote it. She also went on tour with Big Time Rush. They had a world tour, and then she was on the Teen Nick show, Figure Out. She wants to host a red carpet event and have her own tour. Until then, she will write and co-write some songs. And she is an important person in young girls' lives because she is determined to work hard. If you would like to know what happens in the end of this story, then read this book. I would recommend this book because if you like Rachel Crow and you want to know more about her, then you will like this book.
The book I read was called Don't Get Caught, written by E. Robins. One of the main characters is a teenage girl named Paris. Paris is in high school and she loves football. Paris is worried Max is not being honest. She speaks with her best friend Bree and her cousin Trish about the situation. Based on the advice her cousin Trish gave her, she makes a bad decision that she regrets. If you would like to know what happens in the end, read the book. I would recommend this book because it is a great book and it tells you that you should always trust your gut and do the right thing.
All right, now if you want to see this video again or others like it, you can go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on the videos. But now we'll see you do a review question.
I'll do the review question, yep.
All right.
Okay. This particular question that we're going to review today was taken from the Integrated Algebra exam last August, so August of 2013. It's a multiple choice question, so one of the nice things is the answer is up there for us. I'm still going to show you all the work. But this one here, you'd only get the answer at full value if you get it correct. All right, so let's go through this. They want to know which equation, so we're going to have an equal sign, which equation is true. And then they give us four separate equations. Well, the only way that I know to really attack this is to look them over and do them, do each one separately. So I'm going to do number choice one first, and it's a division problem. Now again, it's a time test, so you want to move as quickly as you can, but make sure that you do things properly. And in this case here, I have a division problem, so I'm going to change it, keep the first fraction the same, but I'm going to change it to a multiplication problem, as you would any fractional division problem. All right, and I did the reciprocal of that second fraction. So now on the left side, I would have this value here. I want to see when I calculate this left side, will I get the value that is on the right side for choice one? Well, c to the fifth times c to the one, we know to add the numerators in this case. So we have c to the sixth. Well, right away, I can see that this one's not going to work because I already have an incorrect numerator. The bottom would... I did 5, oh, this should be, yeah, c to the 1. I added the exponents. Did I say multiply? I meant to say add, thanks. So I add the exponents. When I get to this choice here, when I get a power of a power, I would multiply. So this is right. So I get c to the 6th over d to the 10, but this choice doesn't work. All right, let's go to choice 2. All right, again, a little bit different. Now we got a power of a power. So let's do the left side, and we'll see if it equals the right side. Well, the left side has this fairly complex term. But now we got a power of a power. Now we're not going to add the exponents. We'll multiply the exponents. Well, first, the whole numbers, negative 2 times negative 2 times negative 2, I know would give us negative 8. But that doesn't give us any final result because that had a negative 8. M to the second times m to the third is m to the sixth. Power of a power, you multiply the exponents. And p to the 1, I'll put a 1 here. Our viewers can see that. 1 times 3, put a 1 here as well, gives us p to the 3rd. Now again, we can stop here. Okay, we're trying to work as quickly as we can because this choice here is the one that worked. If you have time, it might benefit you in some instances to go back and solve the rest of them. Well, let's do this guy here. Let's do choice 3 and prove that it does not equal that value on the right side. Well, power of a power would give us s to the 6th, t to the 16th, over, I like this one because we're going to have to do a division at the end, s to the 8th power, t to the 10th. Now, the nice thing here, we can do a little bit more work. When we have division, we subtract the exponents. Well, 6 minus 8 in the denominator will give us s squared. 16 minus 10 in the numerator would give us t to the 6th. Well, this one had t to the 5th. So choice 3 did not work. All right. These are fun problems because they all have a little bit different kink to each one of them. All right. Here we got two separate terms that we can multiply. Negative 2 times 3 gives me negative 6. A squared times a to the 1. Now again, we're back to adding the exponents. So we have a to the 3rd. And b to the 3rd times b squared, well, we add the exponents, is b to the 5th. So again, we don't have a negative 6 value here leading that term. So choice 4 did not work either. So again, choice two was the one that did have the proper equation that was true. Thanks.
I said, hey, hey, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
All right, Ed, we're going to do another review question. We're going to do a living environment question, so I'm going to go to the board. And this is a multiple choice question that I thought was kind of interesting because we could talk about some of these vocabulary words. All right, it says, deer ticks are responsible for spreading Lyme disease. All right, many people have heard of Lyme disease. It is here in New York State now and actually comes from the town of Lyme where it was first identified. Now, this organism, which feeds on the blood of warm-blooded organisms like mice, deer, and humans, is best described as a... Okay, the actual disease isn't caused by the tick that spreads it, but actually a bacteria that's spread by this tick, all right, that causes the disease. But we got words up here like predator, scavenger, parasite. You know, these are all things we kind of think about as preying on other things. Well, predator, by definition, a predator is a consumer that kills its own prey, okay? Usually, ticks aren't going to kill you. You might get the disease. The tick isn't going to kill you. The disease might make you very sick, but that's actually from the bacteria, not the tick. Okay? Scavengers. They're also meat eaters, carnivores, but usually they don't kill their prey. They take what's left over from something else. Okay? You see crows maybe on a roadkill on the side of the road where a deer or something's been hit. All right? Parasite is an interesting one. Parasites are actually going to feed on a host. Okay, so in this case, the tick is the parasite, the warm-blooded animal would be the host. But parasites usually don't want to kill their whatever it is they're preying on because then they'd have to find something else, right? So they may make you sick, and often do, but usually the parasite tries not to kill whatever its host is. And this is a perfect example of a parasite-host type relationship. Same thing happens if you're bitten by a mosquito. You know, the mosquito would be the parasite, you'd be the host. But one mosquito bite isn't going to kill you. If you had thousands of them, it might. But there's the problem is that the parasite doesn't kill its host. Because otherwise, it's got to look for more hosts to survive at. Okay? So this was an interesting one, but the right answer is it's a parasite relationship. Okay?
I said, hey, hey!
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Joe, we've got a winner in your science challenge.
Hello, Regina, are you there?
Yeah.
What is our answer? What is this force that we're measuring?
It's the force of friction against the surface.
It is. That's the friction. And friction is a force that opposes motion, right? So actually it would be in the opposite direction. Because this was the same mass I used each time, right?
Mm-hmm.
Seems like every time I move it, if it's the same mass, it should take the same amount of force to move it. But that wasn't the case, was it?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so I have all these different surfaces. What's this tell us about the friction of these different surfaces? Is it going to be the same on all of them?
No.
No, and actually it was the highest on the one that's like a sandpaper there. You know, the friction was greater. You know what? You use friction all the time, don't you? Do you ever notice when friction is really low, you might have difficulty? You ever try to walk on ice?
Right. I was just going to bring that up with hockey
players. There's a good example. Very low friction, and you have trouble staying up, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Hey, you did a great job. What grade are you in?
Fourth grade.
Fourth, very good, and you knew that friction. Where do you go to school?
Roselleville.
All right, well, I hope your teacher is watching because you did a great job. Thanks, Regina. Congratulations. Oh, you still there?
Well,
you still there, Regina?
Yeah. Yep.
Can you explain a little bit about the ice thing? Why is it that some people are so adept at hand friction, friction, like the skaters? I don't understand how they can really move so glide so easily on that without the friction.
With ice skates, they want there to be low friction to move.
And the less friction, the faster you can move as well.
Less friction, the less opposing your motion. Right. Mm-hmm. The problem for us is when there's such low friction, our foot slides up from under us. It's hard to move. So yeah, very cool. You know, some things we purposely make to have a lot of friction, like your car tires. You know, you don't want those to slide.
Want those to grab the road.
Yeah. So, all right. Well, thanks for John. You did a great job.
All right.
Congratulations. But don't forget now, every correct response goes in our homework hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
Now, that's all the time we have for tonight. We're going to say goodbye, but Dial a Teacher is available with free homework help on the phones until 7 tonight.
Okay, now just a reminder, remember, Dial a Teacher will be closed on Monday for Martin Luther King Jr. Day.
Good night.
Enjoy your day off of school. Bye
good
now.
Night.
In part by New York State United Teachers. NYSUT's 600,000 members are building a brighter future in New York State classrooms, universities, and healthcare facilities. NYSUT, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.